Now, back here in the U.S., the big problem still facing the housing market as states struggle to cope with mounting foreclosures. President Obama proposed some corrective steps today. At the same time, he heads into a tough reelection campaign. With some 11 million homeowners underwater on the value of their homes and 5 million foreclosures expected in the next few years, housing remains a major drag on the U.S. economy. Today, the president headed west to Nevada, the state with the highest foreclosure rate in the country, to roll out a new plan to help some homeowners. The administration announced that it would adjust the so-called Home Affordable Refinance Program, or HARP, to make it easier for borrowers to refinance their mortgages, regardless of how much their home values have dropped. It also would eliminate or waive fees. The plan is open to homeowners with mortgages guaranteed by Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac before June of 2009. Previously, the program would not let homeowners refinance if their mortgage loan exceeded 125% of their home's value, a problem for many Americans. Secretary of Housing and Urban Development Sean Donovan told the NewsHour the changes could Absolutely. Make an important difference.
In normal times, a homeowner that has a mortgage of $250,000 at a 6% interest rate could go out and refinance at 4.5% or lower, given how low today's interest rates are. That would be a savings of $250 a month, $3,000 a year.
Nearly 900,000 borrowers refinanced under HARP until now, far short of an intended goal. Donovan said he didn't know yet how many people would take advantage of the program now, but said there was a market to be tapped.
There are about 4 million underwater homeowners who have a Fannie Mae or a Freddie Mac mortgage and could save a significant amount of money by refinancing. That's the eligible pool. Some share of those will actually take this advantage. They will choose to refinance.
The president came under new fire today for not doing Nothing more to deal with a housing crisis. The latest salvo, a web video from Republican presidential candidate Mitt Romney saying the situation has worsened.
Welcome
to Nevada.
Welcome to Nevada, President Obama.
But Romney and the rest of the Republican field did not offer specific plans of their own to deal with foreclosures during a debate last week.
What would you do as president to help fix the overall problem of real estate and foreclosures in America?
The right course is to let markets work. And in order to get markets to work and to help people, the best thing we can do is to get the economy going. And that's why the fundamental restructuring I've described is so essential to help homeowners and people across this country.
During the president's stop in Nevada today, he said his plan would help, but also acknowledged its limits.
Everybody. These steps that I've highlighted today, they're not going to solve all the problems in the housing market here in Nevada or across the country. Given the magnitude of the housing bubble and the huge inventory of unsold homes in places like Nevada, it's going to take time to solve these challenges.
Some people could begin refinancing in December, but for most borrowers who are underwater, it would begin next year.
We look at now at the housing crisis in Nevada and its political implications. John Ralston is a columnist for the Las Vegas Sun and host of the television show Face to Face with John Ralston. Good to have you with us again.
Hi, Judy.
Let me first ask you, how bad is the housing situation in Nevada and overall the economy?
Well, you heard the president say in states like Nevada, there is no state like Nevada, Judy. We have the highest foreclosure rate in the country. 60% of the people in the state are underwater on their homes. We have the highest unemployment rate in the country at 13.4%. And those are just the people who are still looking for jobs. It's probably much worse than that, maybe double that number. And President Obama stepped right into one of the worst parts of that housing crisis today in Las Vegas.
And to what extent, John, do you believe people there believe this is the president's fault? Or where do they assign responsibility?
Well, I think they're just upset, and I think that they're starting to tune out what anyone says, including the president. They just want some help of any kind. It was interesting you played those responses from the debate. I was actually stunned. As much as the Republicans want to talk about free market solutions, I think a lot of people in this state, and especially in this city where it's really been bad for the foreclosure crisis, think that that free market was not so free, that it was rigged. They see banks being bailed out. They see Wall Street being bailed out, and they wonder when they're going to get some relief. You know, that plan that the president announced today, the expansion of HARP, probably won't help a lot of the people he was talking to today. Judy, let me just give you one example. That street that he was on today, the president was on today, a house there, a specific house we looked up, was worth $210,000 in 2007. A month ago, it sold for less than $70,000.
So, but you're saying many of these houses, many of the homeowners in your state are not going to be able to take advantage of what the administration announced today.
Well, as you know, the details are still coming out on this. If it's just Fannie and Freddie mortgages guaranteed before 2009, I'm not sure how many people that's going to help. And some of these people are underwater in their homes way more than 125%. How far are they going to go? And at some point, this does cost somebody some money. So I think it's still unclear. But it's interesting because I think President Obama had a lot of reasons for going into that specific neighborhood because it's been so hard hit. And, of course, there's a campaign component of all this. He came from the Las Vegas Strip, of one of the fanciest hotels on the Strip, the Bellagio, where he raised a lot of money to this very poor neighborhood, a predominantly Hispanic neighborhood, a community that voted for him by 70-20 in 2008, but has been very hard hit, very upset, and his numbers are not nearly so good with Hispanics right now in this state, Judy.
Very quickly, John, any sense of specifically what people want to help them with the housing problem?
Well, I'm sure they'd love for a truck with a bunch of money to dump it on their doorstep. But I think they want some light at the end of the tunnel. They want some hope. There's a foreclosure mediation program here put on by the state. The governor says it's a model for the country, but it hasn't worked as well as it should have because the banks are making it difficult. I think they want to see some action to force the banks to deal with them. On the other hand, the president even and probably agrees with the Republicans. You can't just have the banks forgive all those loans. Could they do better principal reductions? Could they work more solicitously with the homeowners? That remains to be seen. They want relief, Judy. They don't care who it comes from, who takes credit.
We hear you. John Ralston joining us from Las Vegas. Thank you.
Bet.
And next, we assess the substance of the plan, what kind of difference it might make and might not make. We check in now with two people who watch this closely. John Taylor is president of the National Community Reinvestment Coalition, which focuses on housing in traditionally underserved communities. He has served on housing advisory boards for both Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. And Susan Wachter, she's professor of real estate and finance at the Wharton School at the University of Pennsylvania. It's good to have you both with us. I'm going to start with you, Susan Wachter. We just heard, and I believe you were able to hear him, John Ralston in Nevada describing the situation out there. He said what people want is a light at the end of the tunnel, some kind of help. Do you see in this new plan that the administration rolled out today something that homeowners like them will be able to grab onto?
Yes, I do. I think it's a win-win. I don't think it's a game changer, but I think it does help get to that light at the end of the tunnel. I think it's a help. It's a help not only for the homeowners who will be able to take advantage of the historically low interest rates, who could not before because they were underwater far too far. And of course, that's directly Nevada will have many of those homeowners. But it also will help the market because fewer homes will come on to the market, continuing downward pressure.
John Taylor, what do you see in today's proposals from the administration that could make a difference?
I'm not as optimistic as my friend Susan, but because I really look at this as incremental steps, and that what we really need right now is a giant leap forward. There's simply not going to be an economic recovery without housing recovery. And because they've limited it to the people who can access this program are those who are already paying. With one exception, if you were late 30 days for in the last 12 months, you'd still qualify. So people who were just hanging on, who whose mortgage payments are too much, but are paying almost every month, you know, seven out of 10 months they're on time, but 3 months they're delinquent, they won't be eligible. And those are precisely the people who would be the most helped by this. And it's the biggest pool of people, I think, that would become eligible. The pool is just too small if you limit it to those who have are either current on their loans or just had one delinquency in the last year.
So, Susan Wachter, if it's just limited to this small group, how will it make a difference?
Well, it's small relative to the overall depth of the problem of potentially 11 million homes that are out there with borrowers who are underwater. But it might help as many as a million homeowners who are underwater, and that's a million more than have been helped to date. So for those homeowners, it clearly will make a difference, and it can help in a market that is very fragile at this point. And whether it's at a point of a second leg down, and of course if that happens, then, you know, I'm with John. We are near a real problem, not only for housing, but for the overall economy in a vicious cycle. But it can help stabilize in 2012, which is going to be a year of great concern and need for stabilization, not only from that, but from other factors, from other interventions, like keeping interest rates low, so that such plans like this, borrowers can access these really historic low interest rates.
So, John Taylor, this point, again, that we heard John Ralston raise, that essentially the administration is saying they're going to cover, if your home is, if the value is less, I guess, or has dropped more than 125%, the overall value of the mortgage, then is that the part of it that you think?
They're actually, sorry, Judy, but they're actually going to not have any ceiling. So regardless of the loan to value, you'll be eligible if you're current on your payments or only missed one payment or been delinquent one time in the last 12 months. So they're actually removing, but there's a problem there too, because the current level is 125% of loan to value. So if your value of your house is 125% less than if your loan to value ratio of your house is 125%, they're saying that it can go up to 150, it can go beyond that. The problem is what Fannie and Freddie have been doing is only refinancing loans. 95% of the loans they have refinanced have been at 105%. So even at 125, which is their current level, they haven't been making these kind of adjustments or these refinances for even loans up to 125%. So what's going to make them go very high to 150, 175% of loan-to-value ratios? It's going to be a real challenge for them. And so everybody wants us to grab this housing problem and this foreclosure problem by the throat and kill it, because it's killing the economy. But if we don't have either principal write-downs, we don't have the option of bankruptcy where people can protect their homes, we don't have what FDR did when houses crashed for his citizens, and he put a moratorium on foreclosures and then created a corporation to refinance these loans and make these loans. We don't have any of that. It's just all voluntary. Let's all work together and hope that as we do these incremental steps, it's going to make a difference. And as Susan pointed out, we have a monumental task in front of us, and we need something bigger than these incremental steps.
Susan, you want to respond to that?
I do. Nonetheless, this is a positive step. This is win-win. And it's not just the, you know, that $70,000 house that we heard from John, that would qualify. It's any home, however underwater, as long as borrowers are current, with that small exception of 30 days. And those people should have this option. So they now will have this option. Why not? This is something that should be available. And besides, there are details in the plan which are pretty ambiguous. So, you know, I'm not sure where it's going to come out, but nonetheless, the details are that more of these will close in before the fees will also be reduced that Fannie and Freddie have been charging, and that could be a game changer also.
And we know there are several elements. Just quickly,
to some degree,
Susan, just quickly, assuming some element of this works, what about the larger housing picture? What are we left with as we look at the next year?
Well, obviously, this is not going to solve our problem. It can help. The problem is if housing prices start to decline again, then we might be in a vicious cycle. The housing market weakens and leading to the overall economy weakening, leading to the housing market. We need price stability. With interest rates at historic lows, we could get to price stability. The key is job growth.
And, John, the same question. What does the rest of the housing picture look like, setting this aside?
Well, considering we have 10 million foreclosures facing us, and unless we get the housing, the building of housing industry restarted, we're going to not see the kind of job creation that I think everybody's hoping for. Susan's right. We need to create jobs. But we will not have an economic recovery if we don't have a housing recovery. We can't worry just about helping a million people. That's obviously important. We need to help 4 or 5 million people to prevent them from going into foreclosure, because that will simply tear against and work against anything this administration or anyone does to create jobs.
John Taylor, Susan Wachter, we thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you.